Morning, everyone. Happy Sunday. I'm Reverend Joel Martinez. I'm so glad that you've joined us. Whether you've joined us in person or online, welcome. We're so glad to have you here. It is the second Sunday of Advent, and we have a special tradition of lighting the Advent wreath. So I'm going to, in a moment, just invite the church family over and to light our candle of peace. Please stand.
Our peace comes from God, who became one of us in Jesus. As we wait for God's time, in faith, we light the candles of hope and peace. Come, let us walk in the light of the Lord.
Blessed are you, holy and living one. You come to your people and set them free. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Merciful God, who sent your messengers, the prophets, to preach repentance and prepare the way for our salvation, give us grace to heed their warnings and forsake our sins, that we may greet with joy the coming of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the readings.
A reading from the book of the prophet Malachi. See, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord as in the days of old and as in former years. The word of the Lord. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel. He has come to his people and set them free. Through his holy prophets, he promised of old that he would save us from our enemies, from the hands of all who hate us. This was the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies. You, my child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare the way. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from Paul to the people of Philippi. I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying in joy in every one of my prayers for all of you, because of your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now. I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work among you will bring it to the completion by the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to think this way about all of you, because you hold me in your heart, for all of you share in God's grace with me, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I long for all of you with the compassion of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may overflow more and more with a knowledge and full insight to help you determine what is best, so that in the day of Christ you may be pure and blameless, having produced the harvest of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ for the glory and praise of God. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, Lord Christ. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Etruria, and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Let us pray. Live without fear. Your Creator has made you holy, has always protected you, and loves you as a mother. Go in peace to follow the good road, and may God's blessing be with you always. Amen. Don't go in peace just yet, but you may be seated. Please. Well, good morning and happy Sunday. It's the second Sunday of Advent. And as such, we're hearing again about the ministry of John the Baptist. And while his apocalyptic style can be challenging, I think this week's gospel reading in particular actually gets to the heart of what the season of Advent is all about. I'm sure you've noticed that this season of Advent, we've changed our liturgical colors. Last week after the service, Maile and I had a lot of people come up to us and comment on our blue vestments and liturgical hangings. Everyone thought they were quite beautiful. And I'll just have to say, a lot of that change was driven by our director of music, Michael Burroughs. He was a big champion for that. And Lauren Fitzpatrick, she made these beautiful hangings as well that we have on the altar and on the pulpit and lecterns. So why don't we give them just a round of applause to say thanks. Furthering on a side note, last week I told Maile back in the sacristy in a certain light, my Chasuble kind of looks like a Smurf blue, sort of. But I'm a child of the 80s, so, you know. But anyway, this change did something that I really love. It made people curious. I really loved that. Everyone wanted to know what was behind the change. For those that may be visiting or are new, we've traditionally used purple during Advent. Purple is a royal color. So it certainly has been an appropriate choice as we've awaited the coming of our newborn king. But you know, it also has penitential connotations. We use purple in Lent, and I think the association with penitence is made pretty strongly there. But blue is a royal color too, and a shift from a focus on penitence to a celebration of anticipation and hope by no means takes away from the preparatory and introspective nature of the season. It just adds to it. Blue, in this usage, represents the darkness before birth, the night sky before the breaking light of dawn, the coming of the king, the theotokos, that's Mary, the God-bearer, and hope, which I think all aligns perfectly with our reading for today. Luke grounds this story in the real world. Luke tells us that the story of Christ is grounded in the history of our world. That's why he lists the emperor, the governor, the rulers, and priests. He's telling us that God did something remarkable and miraculous in our tired, plain old world. And Luke is testifying to us that God's salvific work not only broke into our world amongst all those very, very important people, but also that God didn't choose those rich and powerful leaders to work through. God chose a lowly, ordinary man to fulfill the words of the prophet Isaiah, to announce the coming of God incarnate. And to add on to that, God didn't choose a worldly city to spread his word. Instead, God chose the Judean wilderness as the place for John to deliver his message. Now, whether it's a physical place like the setting of John's ministry or a metaphor for a time or season in our lives, the wilderness is a place where we take time to set ourselves apart from the world. It's a place where we're tested, where we withdraw, and where we pray. That time and space for us is now, in the season of Advent. This is a time not for penance, but for introspection as we prepare our hearts and minds for the gift of the coming of Christ Jesus into our world. Yes, John proclaims a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, but to repent is to simply turn toward God. It's a turning away from something that keeps you from loving God and loving your neighbor as yourself. And that turn is hopeful, because that stirring of our hearts, that desire to grow closer to God, is in itself a gift of God's grace. God's grace always precedes this turn, because our all-merciful, compassionate, and loving God is always seeking us out. God sees you in all your imperfections, as beautifully and wonderfully made and worthy of love. In response to God's grace, love, and mercy, my hope is that we all will want to grow closer to God. And that's where all of this talk about straightening pathways, leveling mountains, and filling in valleys comes into conversation. This time that we find ourselves in now is the night before the dawn, the holy darkness in the womb. This is the time that we prepare for the coming of our salvation from the Christ child, born in a meager stable. I love how our passage for today ends. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God. This is a beautiful reminder of the radical inclusivity of God's love. It's for everyone. This is head-scratching because it doesn't make sense to us when we so easily ourselves hold grudges and judge others. But in God's eyes, no one is left out. No one is left behind. So as we prepare ourselves for the coming of Christ, we must keep that vision close to our hearts and minds. Next week, we will hear the second half of this passage. In it, we get a glimpse of this vision. John basically says, if you have two cloaks, share one of them with a person that has none. If you have food for two, share that also. We're being reminded that salvation isn't reserved for just the other side of eternal life. Salvation is for us right here and right now. The kingdom of God is already here and not yet, but it begins here on earth. That means that it must touch all aspects of our lives, not just the spiritual. The good news of God in Christ, to use John's example, is food for the hungry and clothing for the naked. But it also means more than addressing these symptoms of society's failures. This means we as Christians must do our part to seek out justice in the corrupted systems of our society. You may have heard of the Charity Justice Continuum. This is a way to examine the work that you are involved in, either individually or as part of an organization. There are four basic categories on the continuum: charity, service, advocacy, and justice. To be clear, one isn't better than the other. All four areas must be engaged in our society. Many churches, however, tend to stick to charity and service work. This is important work that meets crucial needs, but God calls all of us in certain ways to work across the entire spectrum. Advocacy work is using your voice, power, and status to improve the lives of others. Justice work empowers others by helping them to use their own voice to address systems and improve their conditions. This work is primarily focused on community organizing with an emphasis on causes and systems. When I was going to seminary, I served at a parish in Washington, D.C. As part of my preparation for the priesthood, I spent a year learning hands-on about community organizing through WIN, that's the Washington Interfaith Network. My time was spent on housing justice for seniors and families. Both groups lived in Potomac Gardens, that's a public housing unit run by the D.C. Housing Authority. Conditions there were horrible. In my first action, we gathered 100 people across different lines of faith, along with 100 or more residents, to meet with the local ward city council member to address housing issues like mold, rats, broken appliances, and so much more. Not only did we get these issues addressed for residents, but we also secured regular monthly check-ins with the council member to make sure things stayed that way, that they stayed fixed. For the seniors, we helped them draft a memorandum of understanding that voiced their needs and concerns regarding a renovation for their building. Many of the seniors were afraid that they'd be forced to leave their homes and wouldn't be allowed to come back once renovations were complete. This MOU protected them from that ever happening. Tangible work like this is included as part of Isaiah's vision of all flesh seeing the salvation of God. As you prepare your heart and mind for the coming of the Christ child, look inside yourself and acknowledge what in your life is keeping you from a closer relationship with God. Making a turn towards God in that way is always important work. But then, in our place and in our time, think about what road of hardship do you see that you are called to make straight and smooth? What mountain of injustice might you be called to bring low? What valley of need must be filled? Where is your heart calling you to prepare the way for God? Amen. Please stand as you're able and join me in saying the Nicene Creed found on page 7 of your order of service. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Holy God, We are, you are there. Stir our hearts wherever we may go, that we may see you and offer thanksgivings for the life you have given us. Hear these prayers we offer as we say, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the church in every place, may we be ever mindful of the richness of the family of God's people, those next to us here, those in neighborhood churches, and those worshiping today across the globe. Help us to grow into a unity of mission and ministry and our common devotion to Christ, that we may be faithfully witness of your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those in civil authority, that they be guided by hope and not fear. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For this faith community, amid joys and sorrows, let us remember those who have gone before us, those who have sacrificed for us. Let us give thanks for the gathering of God's people and for the renewal of life we are given. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
For the sun that shines lights our day, and the moon and the stars that shelter the night, may our eyes be open to the beauty around us. Help us protect and nurture the creation and ever proclaim its wonders. Lord, in mercy, hear our prayer. For those of great risk among us, let us pray for those who are lonely or neglected, for those that are facing illness and disability. Especially we pray for Sylvia Moore, Dorian Reeve, Russ Ryder, Michelle Bloom, Pat Braithwaite, Nathy Keene, Gray Judge, Kajia Fredericks, and those named either in our hearts or on our lips. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those who have died, for those who are dying, and for those who are who grieve, especially those named in our hearts or on our lips, that they may find hope in your promise of lasting life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Lord, gather up our prayers with those of all your people in every place and time, and guide us to Christ, preparing the way for us by making every valley filled and every mountain low. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and deliver us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us show one another a sign of God's peace and greet someone you don't know.
Good morning. Again, welcome to everyone, those who are here and those who are watching our live stream. We are glad that you have joined us. Just a reminder that we will have refreshments in the Fellowship Cafe, which is in the center If you are in this room and can stay and have a cup of coffee, please do so. And if you are a newcomer and visiting or worshiping with us for the first time, please join us, especially we want you, so that we have the opportunity to get to know you a little bit better. In the pews, you will see little white cards. If you would fill out one of those and just put it in the plate, and or you can sign in the registry in the narthex. Either way, it's just a chance for us to get to know you a little bit better. A reminder that the Giving Tree is in the narthex, and they are collecting gift cards, $25 gift cards from Target, Amazon, Safeway, or $10 Subway gift cards to be given to the San Jose State students that are in need. As you know, we have a whole area of folks who need our help, so please be generous, and let's fill that gift box up with gift cards for all of these folks. On December 15th, the bagpipe concert will take place. We get more calls than they do, I think, about it. It's not our concert, but they have it here because they rehearse here every week. And so if you have questions about that concert, you will have to call them, I think, other than it's at 3:00 on December 15th. Also on December 15th at 5 p.m., the Stephen Ministry has a long night service. You may not be familiar with what that is. Sometimes it's called Blue Christmas. It's just in realization that Christmas is not always a joyous time for people. There are plenty of people in our world who find it a very difficult time. And this service, Long Night, is generally, it's a little more low-key of, you know, softer music and prayers for those who really find this time of year difficult. So you certainly can join them on December 15th at 5 p.m. or if you know people in your neighborhood or friends who find this to be a difficult time, please let them know about it. Don't forget about Christmas flowers and music. The envelopes are in the pews. If you will give generously for that, you can do it in memory of someone or in thanksgiving of something. However, it would be great because you know the church is going to be absolutely gorgeous at Christmas. It always is. So, let's see, what else? The Labyrinth was open on Saturday, but nobody came. So if you are interested in coming this coming Saturday on the 14th, please let us know so that we can. It's a lot of work to put out if nobody, I mean, it's a busy time of the year. December is busy, especially on Saturdays. So I can certainly understand that it's not necessarily a great time to have the Labyrinth out, but if you would like to join us for that walk, please let us know. And a reminder that today is the opening of the Cathedral of Notre Dame in Paris. So keep the French in your prayers as this very exciting time in theirs when they were told that it would be 5 years. I know, I listened to it, I thought, that's insane. But it was. It's been 5 years for them to put that place back together, including the organ. Speaking of organs, in March, the organist from Notre Dame is going to be giving an organ recital here. That's pretty cool. Pretty cool. Yeah. So you'll hear more about that, but that is our way of celebrating that. He'll be on the West Coast, and so he's going to stop by here and play our beautiful organ, too. So you'll hear more about it. Anyway, I think that's about it. Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries this week? No. All right. Nobody's being bashful. Okay. All right. Well, it's time for our offering. Please give generously, as God is always generous to us. Walk in love as Christ loved and gave himself for us as an offering and sacrifice unto God.
When is my King a coming? Oh, a coming. Lord, hear my cry.
The King is coming, my King is coming soon. The King is coming, my King is coming soon.
Lord, I am tired and heavy is my burden.
The King is coming, my King is coming soon.
I'm down the valley staring at the mountain.
The King is coming, my King is coming soon.
You split the mighty waters of the Red Sea.
The King is coming, my King is coming soon.
Lord, will you split the rising waters all around me?
The King is coming, my King is coming soon. The King is coming, my King is coming soon. The King is coming, my King is coming soon. The King is coming, my King is coming soon. The King is coming, my King is coming soon.
Well, he showed up for Moses and he showed up for Daniel and he showed up for David when he was Goliath.
Well, he showed up for Moses and he showed up for David and he showed up for Daniel down with the lion.
Showed up. Yes, he showed up.
The world is weary and heavy with its hunger.
My King is coming.
He's coming. My King is coming.
We wait on your promise no matter how much longer.
My King is coming.
My King is coming. My King is coming soon.
A child will be coming. The prophets all have spoken.
My King is coming. My King is coming.
Freeing the captive and healing all that's broken.
The King is coming, my King is coming soon. The King is coming, my King is coming soon. The King is coming, my King is coming soon. The King is coming, my King is coming soon.
Well, he showed up for Moses and he showed up for Daniel and he showed up for David when he was Goliath.
Well, he showed up for Moses and he showed up for David and he showed up for Daniel down there.
Yes, he showed up.
The King will come when the King comes.
Will my King
see the justice roll like thunder? The King will come when the King comes.
Will my King
see the justice roll like thunder?
The King will come
when the King comes.
Will my King
see the justice roll like thunder? Mercy and peace and compassion roll like thunder. When the King comes,
he will come.
See the justice roll like thunder. When the King comes, when the King comes, see the justice roll like thunder.
When is my King?
The King is coming, my King is coming soon. The King is coming, my King is coming soon.
The King is coming, coming.
My King is coming,
coming.
My King is coming,
coming.
My King is coming,
coming.
My King is coming, coming.
My King is coming,
coming.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right and a good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of light and fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we failed to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us, and so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. That you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then, in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word, made mortal flesh in Jesus. Born into the human family and dwelling among us, he revealed your glory. Giving himself freely to death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died for us, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, his friends, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed Andrew, and all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to your honor, glory, and praise, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. All are welcome at God's holy table. Please stand as you're able and join me in saying the Thanksgiving after communion found on page 13 of your order of service. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and of assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. We've got two today. All right. Jerry and Julie, Harry and Susie. In the name of this congregation, we send you forth bearing these holy gifts to Ed Jacklich and Sylvia Moore, that they may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood. We, who are many, are one body, because we all share one bread, one cup. Amen. May the Sun of Righteousness shine upon you and scatter darkness from before your path, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.
And serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.